Folks, Dagan here from PMTVUK, and today I have the absolute pleasure of showing you how to set up a guitar pedal board. We go in depth with the signal chain and where you should put specific pedals in what order and why. And just for the record, all the tones you're hearing are coming from the pedal board. I'm going into a clean amplifier with no reverb or anything. It's going to be a lot of fun. Let's get into it. Thank you, future Dagan. So yeah, this video is for the beginners out there that have just started to dip their toe into the world of guitar effects pedals. There's so many different styles, shapes and sounds you can get from these wonderful little boxes of joy. Overdrives, distortions, modulations, reverbs, loopers, even a tuner and a wah pedal. Where do they go? Do you just plug them all into each other and see what it sounds like? No, you can do, but I'm going to touch on that more in a second. Even the more seasoned guitar players out there, like I work in a guitar store and I see people all the time who are quite established on the old instrument, but I've never really dabbled that much in pedals and don't really know the order in which they should go in. But with that, there is a general consensus, a tried and tested order of pedals that have been used for many, many years through beginner guitar players to famous rock stars and stuff, the order in which they go. But if you want to experiment and be creative and put things in different orders, nothing's going to break. It's just fun to experiment and have some more fun with things, but certain things go at different points of the signal chain to get the best out of them. And that's what we're going to explain in this video. And with that as well, everything I talk about today, the pedal boards, the pedals and different variations, they're all linked in the description box down below. So you can check them out at pmtonline.co.uk. And if you want to add or expand on anything that I talk about in this video, please comment down below and share the love. So yeah, let's get started with the actual boards themselves. Pedal boards are very important things. Just like the pedals that adorn them, they come in many different shapes and sizes. And these days you haven't got to spend a lot of money to get a decent pedal board. It's all well and good rocking up to a gig or practice with lots of pedals in a rucksack, all clanking about, and you have to get them out and plug them all in and then take them back out again. A pedal board allows you to have everything laid out, specifically all velcroed down, so it's just good to go right out the box, right out the bag, let's say. For this example, I'm using a Tuatec pedal board, again, all linked in the description box down below. A lovely lightweight aluminium little board, comes with velcro, and so I'm not going to velcro anything down on the board today because it's not mine. I'm going to show you how you put the pedals on top of it. Another great board to check out as well is the Dodario Expand pedal boards. I use one of them personally because I like to chop and change a lot of pedals out. That's a board which actually has little clips on. You can make it grow or make it shorter depending on the situation and application in which you're using it. But yeah, Tuatec boards are awesome. Pedal train boards are awesome. Pedal boards are awesome. Most pedal boards you see out there come in either like one row or two rows, depending on how many pedals and what kind of way in which you use it. I've got a doubler today, so I can show you lots of different pedals. And what's fun about these doubler boards, I'm going to call them in this video, the rays at the back, so they're tilted up towards you so you can see the pedals and turn them on a bit easier because you're not having to lean over too much the pedals at the front to get the ones at the back. And with the rays bit at the back as well, you can also pop a power supply underneath and hide it away so you haven't got to have it next to your board or velcro to the top. And it's just a bit easy. I'm not going to touch too much on power supplies in this video. We're going to talk about the order itself. It's up to you to power it, whether it be a battery or a power supply. But yeah, that's a pedal board in a nutshell. The benefits of using a pedal board, whether it be a small board or a big board, are just huge. Having everything set up, laid out, good to go, so you haven't got a mess with anything. Everything's velcroed down. Open the bag, like the briefcase on Pulp Fiction. Everything's plugged in, powered up, and good to go. Plug your guitar in one end, have the other end going into your amplifier, it makes setup super quick, it makes set down super quick. So once you finish, guitar in the case, put your pedal board in your bag and off you go to the pub, or home, or wherever you want to go after your gig. What's cool as well is with the gig bags, like especially this Tuatec one comes with, when it's covered, nothing's getting knocked, nothing's getting moved, nothing's getting shifted. So all the controls stay exactly where you want them to stay, and instead of you having to rummage around a bag to find the rest of your cables, most of the time, again, this Tuatec one comes with a little pouch on the bag it comes with, so you just put the rest of your cables in there, and you're good to go. So now let's get into the pedals. The all-important signal chain, enough of the stuff that it sits on, let's talk about the fun stuff. And I wholly believe, as do a lot of musicians and guitar players out there, that the first pedal your guitar signal should hit, whether it be through a wireless or through a cable, should be a tuner, like this lovely little Daddario chromatic tuner right here. Because you want the cleanest, most unaffected signal hitting your tuner pedal when you turn it on to get the most accurate tuning. You don't want to put this after a distortion pedal or a modulation pedal where the whole point of those pedals is to manipulate and change your tone so it sounds totally different coming out the back end than it did going in the front end. You want a clean signal hitting the tuner to get the most accurate tuning. It's always going to have the start of the board as well because it mutes everything. It's awfully handy in a lot of cases. Speaking of having a clean signal chain, if you're into pitch shifting and octavers and stuff, when it comes to other pedals that should be at the start and you want a clean signal hitting it, octavers need to be there as well, whether it be a Boss OC octave pedal or an Electro Harmonix POG, or in this case, a Digitech drop pedal, which is a fantastic little thing. You can be in standard tuning on your guitar and use this to go down to half a step, a whole step, all the way down to an octave, and it doesn't really, you haven't got to change the tune on your guitar. Slid down there, no one saw that though. This is a great pedal, and for the same reason as the tuner, you want a clean signal hitting this so it can track, or any pitch or octave pedal, so it can track as best as it can. If you put this like after a wah pedal and you're rocking back, again, there's no right or wrong way to do it. If you like the sound of it, that's totally fine. If you rock back on a wah pedal, this is trying to pick up the cleanest guitar sound so it can manipulate it and change it in pitch. If you're changing what's going into it, this will find it quite hard to track what's happening. So have this towards the front end or any octave pedal to get the cleanest, most lovely octave sound you've ever heard. Next up, we have a pedal which is very much up for debate, and I feel like it might be in the comment section of this video, and that is a wah pedal. In this case, the lovely Crybaby Mini, which is a little baby size wah. This is a full size wah in a small footprint. So whether you've got a small board or a big board, you can always squeeze in a Crybaby wah. Even where the rocker is, it actually fits really nice under the sole of your foot, so it feels like it's a regular wah. But anyways, there's a lot of debate with this. People like it at the front of the signal chain for the same reason as the tuner and the octave pedals, to get the most cleanest sound going into the wah so you can manipulate those mid frequencies and make them sweep back and forth. However, these sound kick-ass after a fuzz pedal. Totally different kind of vibe, whether it be before distortions, after distortions, in front of modulations or whatever. These are one of the most fun pedals to experiment with and get creative with by placing them in different points of the signal chain. But if you're just starting out, as a rule of thumb, usually you want the cleanest signal hitting a wah so it operates to its best of its ability. If you don't want to be super creative and weird, pop it towards the front of your signal chain. Now you're going to see a bit of a theme running through the first pedals right here. You want the cleanest signal hitting all of these. And next up, we have a compressor pedal. Compression is something that's not used probably as much as it should be, but the whole point of a compressor, like I've got the tightrope compressor by Big Top right here. It's a lovely little affordable pedal that does quite a lot. It's fantastic. The whole point of a compressor is to reduce the dynamic range of the signal. So if you play really loud, it brings it down to a unison level. If you play quietly, it brings it up to that unison level, and you can change the attack and release and stuff. So it kind of just makes everything nice and linear and wonderful. Obviously, for that kind of thing, you can put it before pitch effects and all that kind of stuff. Do you want to pitch or an octave sound hitting a compressor, so it compresses afterwards or before, that's up to you. But it needs to be at the start of the pedal board. Again, you're not going to break anything if you do it otherwise, but before distortions and modulations and all that kind of stuff, so you get more of a purer signal hitting the compressor. So when you see compression on a pedal board, always put it towards the front. Next up, we have the modulation pedals. And again, these can go before or after distortion, whatever you want. Personally, and I see a lot of people doing it, before all the distortions and in the front of the amplifier. You can put these in the effects loop. I'm going to touch on the effects loop later on in this video, but for me, they go between the first effect you'll find and the next effects, which are going to be overdrives, fuzzes, and distortions. And the reason is the same. You want a clean signal hitting it. You don't want to modulate a distorted signal. You want a modulated signal going into an overdrive or a distortion. So you've got things like the chorus pedals out there, flangers, phasers, Phase 90, one of the best pedals on the entire planet, just Edward Van Halen in a box. This is the Phase 95. I love small pedals. You can fit loads of them on a board and get lots of crazy sounds. So yeah, next up, after the effects where you want the cleanest sound hitting it to affect the tones going to hit the rest of them, you're looking at your modulation pedals. Before, you nuzzle on over into overdrives and distortions. And that is the way it should be. Overdrives into distortions. Because an overdrive adds overdrive to your signal. It adds some special seasoning, like the wonderful mid-focused seasoning of a tube screamer, an Ibanez TS-9. It's bloody iconic. And you want that to overdrive something afterwards, a distortion pedal, whether it be a big muff, fuzz pedal, or one of my new favorite pedals on the planet, the 1987 Steel Panther Signature Pedal. This is just a hot rod of JCM Marshall in a box, and it sounds absolutely mint. Distortion pedals, like I say, add something to the sound. They add overdrive to the signal. Distortion pedals distort the signal completely. So you want to drive something going into the distortion. You don't want to have distorted sound and then overdriving it afterwards. Totally can do that. You might like the sound of that, and that is totally fine. But usually, overdrives go into distortions. And distortions, I'm talking about fuzz here as well. But again, with fuzzes, think of this as the preamp of an amplifier. You'd run a fuzz into the preamp of an amplifier. Again, you can have the other way around if you want. But in most cases, you'll see fuzzes going into distortions. And distortions should be the last thing in the signal chain before you start nuzzling into time-based effects like reverb and delay. Now, you might hear the term clean boost mentioned once or twice on your guitar playing travels. Now, a clean boost can go in a couple of different places on your pedal board. You can either use it as a boost, like you would do boosting the signal with an overdrive, like the Ibanez Tube Screamer or a Boss SD1 or something. You can get the MXR microamp, which has like 20 decibels of just clean boost, the Keeley Katana, which boosts it as well, but also gives it a lovely bit of subtle seasoning to make it sound slightly different, like John Mayer loves a bit of Keeley Katana as well. The Dunlop Echoplex, the Exotic Pedals EP boost. All these little kind of boost pedals can either work before distortion pedals to boost the signal and give it a little bit of something something, or you can put it after all that, right at the end of your signal. I'll talk about this in more in a second, to give you an overall solo boost. In the sense right here, I've got the MXR Third Man Electronics Double Down Double Boost because I'm a big Jack White fan, and this is his little signature pedal. However, in most cases, if you're not using two amplifiers, because this can boost two amps at once with different volumes, I'd never use two amplifiers, but Jack White does, so you just use one side of this or one, it's essentially two MXR microamps in one. You'd put that right at the end of your signal chain to then bring everything up for a solo boost. So you can either put that in front of your distortion to boost the signal, because once it goes into the distortion pedal, that kind of takes over and kind of turns it into its own different beast that comes out the back end of it, or right at the end of your signal chain after everything else to give the overall volume a boost for solos. If you have a distorted amplifier, a distorted preamp, that will then work the same way as a distortion pedal. So you're distorting a distorted preamp, and then the boost, getting confused, the boost will go into the front of the distorted preamp. It won't boost the volume, but it'll boost the signal that's going into it. So in that case, if you want a solo boost with an amplifier which is distorted, you then put it in the effects loop. Now let's talk about time-based effects, that boost again, and how an effects loop works. So like I said in the intro of this video, I'm running all these pedals into a clean amplifier, into the front of a clean amp, using it as like a pedal platform. It's straight into the preamp in the front. So I can show you how to set out the pedals and stuff and use distortions with overdrives and get the tone from this into the amp, then into your lovely ears. The way an amplifier is actually made is there's two main sections. There's the preamp, and this is whether it be valve or solid state or whatever. There's a preamp and a power amp. The preamp is where you get the tone. That's where all the tone shaping is. Whether it be a clean amp or a distorted amp, the preamp is where you get the tone. And the power amp section of the amplifier is where you get the power. That's where you get the volume and everything. So the tone is created in the preamp, the power amp gives you the volume and the power. And what sits in between the preamp and the power amp of most amplifiers is an effects loop. So that's an in and out, where you can put time-based effects and effects that you want to manipulate after your core sound is created. Because a lot of the times, if you put a reverb pedal, which has a lovely kind of trail on it, or a delay, you want to hear that. And if you put that before a distortion pedal on your board, again, you're not going to break anything, it can sound quite fun sometimes, or hitting a dirty preamp of an amplifier. Again, this is mostly the case with dirty amplifiers. When it's clean, run it however you want, but with a distortion distorted preamp of an amplifier, afterwards you get the effects loop, but you want that distorted sound to then delay. Don't want to distort a delayed sound because it can sound a bit naff. That's the same for modulation pedals as well. Some people prefer putting modulation pedals in the effects loop of an amplifier because it's a bit more subtle, it's a bit less intense, but I personally like the intensity of hitting the front of the amplifier. But delays and reverbs, as a rule of thumb, usually go in the effects loop of the amp. And like I said, I'm running everything straight into the front because I like the sound of this preamp of the amplifier. The clean sound is affected lovely by these distortions and overdrives. But if you want to run like a preamp pedal, like this 1987 Steel Panther pedal, or a really good quality distortion pedal, like a Friedman BE distortion pedal, you can actually run that, skip out the entire preamp of your amplifier and run it into the effects loop in the back, and actually use the pedal as a preamp and totally miss out the preamp section of the amplifier and do it that way. That's another video completely. You could just run this not onto the front of the amplifier, straight into the effects loop return, I guess. But yeah, because the way the amplifier is created with the way the tone shaping works, it's best to put time-based effects in the effects loop. I think that made a lot of sense. I needed a whiteboard to write it all down at the same time, but yeah, That's how an effects loop works. And circling back into the boost pedal, that's why it's right at the end of the effects loop, or in this case, the signal chain. Because you don't, unless you want to, boost the preamp of a distorted amplifier will just enhance and boost the sound of the preamp, the core part of the amplifier, where if you want a solo boost, you'll put it after where the core sound has been made in the effects loop to then boost it in volume before it goes into the power amp. Quick little explanation there of how a preamp and a power amp works and an effects loop. And all that aside, that's kind of how I've got this running. So regardless of the wonderful clean channel of the amplifier I'm running through today, everything is running through. The core sound is coming from the 1987 Steel Panther pedal. That is essentially the preamp of this amplifier I've got on my pedal board. And what's coming after it are the time-based effects, what would be in an effects loop, let's say. And now I'm going into the amplifier, which I'm also using the preamp of, but it's a clean amp, so it's fine. And that's giving you the volume. So that's all that. And finally, with the delay and reverb that I touched on before, a lot of people prefer reverb before delay or after delay. Again, there's no right or wrong way. Do you want to delay a reverb signal, or do you want to craft a delay sound with a repeat and then put reverb on after? It's up to you. But again, with the effects loop, once you've got your core sound sorted, whether it be in the effects loop or creating your core sound on a pedal board, have it afterwards, because if you repeat something into the preamp, it can get really muffled and distorted and sound a bit naff. In some cases, it sounds great, like Eric Johnson and stuff like that. But a lot of the time, you want a clean repeat or a clean reverb trail, so it will go after the preamp pedal, distortion pedal, or the preamp of an amplifier in the effects loop. That leads me on to the last pedal. If you want to, if you ever so choose to use a looper to loop what you've done and jam with yourself, this is the Ringmaster Looper by Big Top Effect. It's got one knob on and it loops what you've done back to you. You record it once, it records it, press it again, it plays it back with the volume control. Press it and have some fun. This should be the last thing in the signal chain, because you want to loop everything, I guess. And it can, in some cases, I guess, go before or after the boost pedal, depending on if you want to boost certain things. But a lot of the times, if you want to play a bit louder over a loop, you just turn the loop down with the volume right here. So even if this was to go at the end of your pedal board, the end of a pedal board with the time-based effects in the effects loop, it would sound a bit naff looping directly into the preamp if the preamp was distorted. But if you put it in the effects loop, it's an affected signal, then getting repeaters and loop, and you can alter the preamp whatever you like. You can play a clean loop and then put some distortion on through your amplifier and still keep the maintained clean signal, because that sound's been recorded from the preamp into this. I hope this is making sense. I'm getting a bit deep right now, but yeah, the looper should go right at the end of your board so you can loop everything. So now, just as important as the pedals themselves are the cables in which we use to patch them all together. Patch cables. They come in many different shapes and sizes. You get regular kind of right angle ones. You can get flat pancake end ones, so they all kind of fit nice and snug together on your pedal board, allowing you to fit more pedals on and have even more fun than you were before. Different lengths, different sizes, you can get straight ones, you can get angled ones. It's a lot of fun, and they're way cheaper than you expect. Again, Tuatec, they make the pedal board, make so many different variations of patch cables, perfect for your board. Because again, a lot of the time, so the guitar goes into the tuner, all the way along, right here, then you've got to get up here somehow, to the distortion pedal. They do make long patch cables to go from there to there. I've got one right here that we're going to have a bit of fun with, and then out into the either the effects loop of your amplifier, like we spoke about before, or the front end of your amp. So now, I'm going to patch it all together. So there we are, everything's plugged in and powered up, and one of the best things about having an actual pedal board is the fact that you can hide all the cables to make it look nice and neat and proper. For the sake of this video, I haven't done that because I haven't got the time, so all the patch cables are hidden somewhat, but the power supplies are still on the top. You can use meticulous as you want, like I said, but yeah, this is how we're going to rock for the end of this video. I'm powering everything with an MXR ISO brick as well, my personal favourite power supply because it's lovely and quiet, but there's so many different options out there. A great budget option is the Big Top power generator, but there's Voodoo Labs power supplies, there's obviously MXR, there's T-Rex, so many different options out there to power these wonderful things that we call pedals. So yeah, like I said at the start, I'm going to a clean amp. Bit of reverb, why not? It was a bit intense. So that, in a nutshell, is a bit of an in-depth demo in how to set up a pedal board. Why should things go in certain places? Again, do whatever you want, have a lot of fun, and comment down below your crazy experiments and experiences of mixing and matching pedals. But yeah, in a nutshell, that's the most common way to do things, and it's been a lot of fun talking about pedals because I love them all to bits. If you want any more information on any of the pedals that I've spoken about in this video, everything's linked in the description box down below so you can check it out at pmtonline.co.uk. If you liked the video, give it a thumbs up and hit subscribe. We are playing music today on all social media platforms. I've been Dagan, and I'll see you next time.